الله الرحمن الرحيم وصلى الله وسلم على سيدنا ونبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم وبعد. الحمد لله رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي ثم أما بعد. السلام عليكم. Thank you for inviting me. So I've decided to start with something interesting. It's the book of Imam al-Ghazali, Muhammad al-Ghazali, Ihya Ulum al-Din, the revival of the sciences of religion. And because I love him very much, everyone loves him. He's a great reformer of the 5th century. We're not going to speak about his life, but he was a great scholar. He was Hujjatul Islam, as you all know. And it's a little ambitious to start with this book. I would have preferred that, but inshallah we can go back and forth. We leave this inshallah open. We can interact. We can hear from you, and we can discuss this. The first book that I read from Imam al-Ghazali is Mukashafat al-Qulub, the unveiling of the hearts. Okay. Amazing book, short. I've read this. I read this for a long time. Alhamdulillah, I kept reading it and rereading it at a certain point in my life, and was very enlightening. And then about 10 years later, I started to look into the book of Al-Ihya Ulum al-Din. So the first book, one of the barakah of following the book of a scholar, is to start from the beginning. It's impossible to go through every page, to every line, but at least we start from the beginning. So we'll say قَالَ الْمُؤَلِّفُ رَحِمَ اللَّهُ, and we'll start with at least the content of this book. Some of you know about this book. So the first chapter of the Kitab al-Ilm, there's seven chapters or sub-chapters. The first one is Fadl al-Ilm wa-Ta'allum wa-Ta'leem, the virtue of knowledge, of teaching it and learning it. The second one is it speaks about the rulings. Is it Fard? Is it Fardu Ayn? And so on. The third one is فِيمَا تَعُدُّهُ الْعَامَةُ مِنْ عُلُومِ الدِّينِ وَلَيْسَ مِنْهَا. Some of them is conceptions of the masses. Some of us think that certain things are part of knowledge or part of the... So he speaks about the stuff which is recommended to learn and stuff that is not recommended to learn. The fourth one is very interesting. أَفَاتِ الْمُنَاظَرَةِ وَسَبَبْ اشْتِغَلَ النَّاسِ بِالْخِلَافِ وَالْجَدَلِ. And this is what a lot of us are now stuck with. We're stuck with arguing, you know, knowing who's right, who's wrong, who's a sheikh, whose school shall we follow, and so on. So it speaks about the risks and the perils of this form of acquiring knowledge. And the fifth one is the etiquette of the student and the teacher. How one deals with his teacher, how does a student deal with knowledge itself. Sixth one is the perils of the scholars, knowledge and scholars. There's a lot of risk once one starts to learn. The scholar himself have to be very, very careful about certain dangers that go on in his own heart. And also the difference between the scholars of the dunya and the akhirah. And the last one speaks more about philosophy. So I'm going to speak about the first part, the virtues of knowledge. Very easy. This is probably the easiest part. And the manhaj of Imam Ghazali starts with like all the scholars, Quran, Hadith, Athar, and then some of the stories from the early generations. I'm going to try and jump into other parts because we only have a few, maybe an hour, maybe, I don't know, we'll see. Inshallah, Bismillah. So, قَالَ مُؤَلِّفْ رَحْمَ اللَّهُ, we spoke about that. And now, about the virtues of knowledge. I don't want it to be boring. You know, just quoting verses. Okay, Allah says in the Quran, "Shahid Allah annahu la ilaha illa huwa wal malaikatu wa ulul ilmi qa'iman bil qist." Shahid Allah. Allah is the one who witnesses about la ilaha illallah. So the first and most important knowledge is tawhid, la ilaha illallah. And the second subject of those who witness this are the angels, wal malaikatu, and the third one. He raises and honors those the people of knowledge. Wa ulul ilmi qa'iman bil qist. So this is very, it's a great testimony of honor to the people of knowledge, that Allah puts them with him and the angels. And then he says, يَرْفَعُ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ آمَنَ مِنْكُمْ وَالَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْعِلْمَ دَرَجَاتٍ. So he says that for those who have knowledge, there are different levels. The scholar, the prophets are not like the even the prophets between themselves are different in the levels of scholarship and knowledge. They say there's two opinions about whether Al-Khadir is alive. Do you know about that? Some say that he has passed away. And some say that he's still alive, but he goes to Hajj every year. So you can meet with Al-Khadir in Tawaf during the Hajj. So that's a strong opinion. And they say that all the prophets have learned from Al-Khadir, just like Musa alayhi salam. But Al-Khadir has learned from Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So that the level of the knowledge of the Prophet Muhammad is much higher. And the knowledge of the prophets is not like the knowledge of the companions. And even between the companions, there's fuqaha al-sahaba. And then there's the fuqaha of the tabi'een. And then we have different generations. So Allah says in the Quran, يَرْفَعُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا مِنْكُمْ دَرَجَاتٍ يَرْفَعُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا مِنْكُمْ وَالَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْعِلْمَ دَرَجَاتٍ. So he raises them in different stations. And this knowledge is a knowledge, not just the knowledge of here, but the knowledge of here. Okay? So that's something which is sometimes hard to grasp and understand. The knowledge that companions learned from the Prophet ﷺ is not just the knowledge of a Sharia. This is the first knowledge. This is the first knowledge. عِلْمُ الْجَوَارِحِ. The knowledge of how you should do your wudu. It's like, you can't run away from that. This is our deen. But there's also the other knowledge which the companions learn from his person. And that's something like the man who came and told him, Ya Rasulullah, I want to be a Muslim, but I want to continue to fornicate, yeah? Sleep with women. He said, come here, and he spoke to him. At the end, he put his hand on his chest, and he made dua for him. He says, after that, I was cured. There was something else that we learn from the physical proximity of those teachers, and it has to do with al-adab and so on. Imam Ibn Ata'illah Sakandari, you know him? You know who's Ibn Ata'illah? If you search him, that's one of the first stories you read. So he goes to his teacher, Abu al-Abbas al-Mursi. what? What's wrong? Listen, all these guys, all these names that I'm going to mention are great scholars. Ibn Ata'illah was a great Maliki scholar of Egypt, and his teachers were Al-Mursi. Al-Mursi was, imagine, all his teachers, the teacher of Al-Mursi also only had one teacher, but they were scholars. And he came, so Ibn Ata'illah went to his teacher, Abbas Al-Mursi, and he was in a very, very humble place, and the person admitted him. So he says, when I was admitted in, and he was so filled with, you know, with distress, when he got in, the teacher got up, and he was so happy to meet with the student. And the student said, I am not worthy of this station. My teacher is getting up, and he's very, you know, very bubbly with me. But as soon as he saw him, he says, أُحِبُّكَ فِي اللَّهِ. That's the first thing he could think of. I love you in Allah. And then he started to speak about his problems. He told him this and that. And he says, listen, life is four things. There's only four things in life, nothing else. فِي الْحَيَاةِ الْأَرْبَعَةِ أَشْيَاءَ لَا خَمِسَ لَهُمَا. So he says, النعمة والبلية والطاعة والمعصية. He says, you are either in a state of bliss or a state of hardship. And you are either doing something which pleases Allah, you're obeying Him, or you're disobeying Him. Okay? So he says, if you are in the state of baliya, you have to be patient. And if you are in a state of ni'mah, of bliss, you have to be thankful. And if you are in the state of ta'a, you have to understand that it's not from you. It's because Allah is allowing you to do that. It's not from your own virtues. And if you are in a state of ma'asiyah, you have to ask Allah for forgiveness. He says he left and he came back after a few days. And he asked him, so how are you now? He says, فَتَّشْتُ عَلَى الْهُمُومِ وَلَمْ أَجِدْهَا. I'm looking for this distress that I was in, and I cannot find it. He told him, أَلْزِمْ فَإِنْ لَزَمْتَ فَوَاللَّهِ لَتَصْبَحَ مِنْ لَتَصْبَحَ مِنْ مُفْتِينَ الْمَذْهَبَيْنِ مُفْتِيًا فِي الْمَذْهَبَيْنِ. He says, you should stay on this course. And if you stay on this course, by Allah, you will become a great scholar in the two schools. And they have explained, عِلْمُ الظَّاهِرِ وَعِلْمُ الْبَاطِنِ. So the knowledge of Sharia, so we have to learn about hadith and Arabic and tafsir and so on, and to learn about the Sharia of Allah and His Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You also have to learn about it. So he said, you will learn these two things, and this is what is meant by innama yakhsha Allah min ibadihi al-ulama, that those who are truly fearful of Allah, or those who truly revere Allah, you know, who magnify him whatever word you should use, are those who are knowledgeable. And that knowledge, من عباده العلماء, are those who are knowledgeable in those forms of knowledges. So it says here, you know, they are different in stations. And Allah even says, قُلْ هَلْ يَسْتَوِي الَّذِينَ يَعْلَمُونَ وَالَّذِينَ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ. Say, do those who know are equal to those who do not know? Okay. Are we equal to Abu Bakr in knowledge? Impossible. Are we equal to Abu Huraira? It's impossible. هَلْ يَسْتَوِي? So this is a strong question. And here as well, إِنَّمَا يَخْشَى اللَّهُ مِنْ عِبَادِهِ الْعُلَمَاءُ. And it says also, كَفَى بِاللَّهِ شَهِدًا بَيْنِي وَبَيْنَكُمْ وَمَنْ عِنْدَهُ عِلْمُ الْكِتَابِ. كَفَى, قُلْ كَفَى بِاللَّهِ شَهِدًا بَيْنِي وَبَيْنَكُمْ. It's sufficient that Allah is witnessed between me and you. And it says, وَمَنْ عِنْدَهُ عِلْمُ الْكِتَابِ. The people who have the knowledge of the kitab are also shaheed. Okay, they are shuhada. Imam al-Shafi'i used to say, "Malikun hujjatun bayni wa bayn Allah." Can you grasp this? Imam Malik used to say that. Imam al-Shafi'i, of course, Imam al-Shafi'i is also his. Highly virtuous in his own rights, subhanAllah, they're all great men. He says, Malik is the testimony between me and Allah. Okay? And that's why we say Hujjatullah, and then the Shias also say Hujjatullah and Ayatullah. And all. That's what they meant. That's what they mean by that. Okay, they don't go, there's differences between us, but this is what they mean. So Hujjatullah, And when you study the seerah of Imam Malik, he's also known as Hujjatul Ummah. Okay, he's taken from the words of Imam Shafi'i, that he is a testimony of the Ummah. Because they used to think that Al-Muwatta is the most authentic book after the Qur'an. And some of the Malikis still believe so. Abu Bakr ibn al-Arabi believes so, and others. So this is the station of the ulama. The station of the ulama is very, very virtuous. And Allah says in the Quran, Ya Bani Adam, قَدْ أَنزَلْنَا عَلَيْكُمْ لِبَاسًا يُوَارِي سَوْآتِكُمْ وَرِيشًا. Ya, the people of Adam, the children of Adam, we have revealed upon you, أَنزَلْنَا عَلَيْكُمْ لِبَاسًا. Libasan is knowledge. Libasan. أَنزَلْنَا عَلَيْكُمْ لِبَاسًا يُوَارِي سَوْآتِكُمْ. It covers your private part. It covers your what one should not see. So your knowledge is what gives you honor. Warisha, walibasu taqwa. Warisha is yaqeen. So that knowledge that protects you is, the highest level is the yaqeen. Walibasu taqwa, thalika khair. And taqwa is what makes you earn, or earns you the haya. This is what they say. Haya is your humbleness and your bashfulness. And وَالْحَيَاءُ لَا يَأْتِي إِلَّا بِخَيْرٍ. And we know that the Prophet ﷺ was more bashful than the virgin who never left her home, and so on, and all those beautiful hadith that portrays the Prophet ﷺ. So these are some of the virtues. Let's see what else we see here. Also Allah says, خَلَقَ الْإِنسَانَ عَلَّمَهُ الْبَيَانِ. He speaks about how He created him, and then beside that, he couples that phrase and that statement with that he has taught him. So this is the great thing that he has given him. And Allah, the Prophet ﷺ used to say, the very famous hadith, "Man yuridillahu bihi khayran yufaqihu fid din." The one whom Allah wishes good for him, he increases him in knowledge. And you know what he said about Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma? Allahumma faqihu fid din wa alimu al-ta'wil. And in one hadith, Allahumma alimu al-kitab. He was, the Prophet ﷺ went to do his biological things. He went to do his washroom, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And Ibn Abbas brought the water for his wudu, for washing. The water is called wudu. So he brought it to him. And when he went out, he says, "Who brought it?" He said, "It's Ibn Abbas." And he says, "Allahumma faqihu fi din wa alimu ta'wil." And in one hadith, this is in Bukhari and Muslim. And in one hadith, he says, "Dhammani Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam." He squeezed me. And he says, "Allahumma faqihu fi din wa alimu ta'wil." Just like who? Jibreel. When he hugged the Prophet and told him, "Iqra, iqra, read knowledge." And he, dhammahu, dhammahu, in the state of, in the case of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is like everything. Like, dhammahu, and he says, "Allahumma faqihu fi din." Imagine being touched by the Prophet in that way. Yeah, you can just leave this dunya. It's amazing, you know. Allahumma salli wa sallam ala Sayyidina Muhammad. And of course, we're still speaking about the virtues of knowledge and the scholars. And he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, al-ulama'u warathatul anbiya. Those who inherit the prophets are the scholars. And he also said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, wayastaghfiru lil'alimi ma fis samawati wal ard. And everything in the heavens and the earth make istighfar for the scholar. And the book of Imam Ibn Abd al-Barr al-Qurtubi, Jami' al-Bayan al-Ilmi wa Fadlihi, Jami' al-Bayan al-Ilmi wa Fadlihi, he has like, this is a little volume like this, or two volumes. It's not a beautiful book about knowledge, just knowledge, and its virtues, and the virtues of the scholars and the students. He says that everything, and the hadith mentions everything in heavens, the angels, the stars, the animals in the earth, حتى الحيتان في البحر يستغفرون لمعلمين الناس العلم. And even the fish in the sea pray and ask forgiveness for those who teach people al-khayr. And he includes those who learn and those who teach. This is included. The students and the teachers. So all of them are included in this beautiful hadith where everyone asks forgiveness for you. So if you learn, if you go out and learn about religion, deen, and these forms of knowledges, everyone asks forgiveness for you. There's more and more here. خِصْلَتَانِ لَا يَكُونَانِ فِي مُنَافِقٍ. And here, all of a sudden we speak about the hypocrites. Two things that you cannot find in a hypocrite. Two things. حُسْنُ سَمْتٍ, the beautiful demeanor and presentation. Like it's not, and there is the fake. The fake demeanor, like, you know, you're like this, but inside of you, like that breaks very fast. Someone who's faking a piety, it breaks very quickly. And so, two things which cannot be found in a hypocrite: husnu samtin wa fiqhin fid din. Okay, a beautiful demeanor, truly beautiful demeanor, and knowledge in religion. And which brings us to, you know, this goes into another topic which we will cover hopefully inshallah sometime. But there's different levels of the believers and Muslims. Muslims, the first one is the one that says La ilaha illallah, but he's a munafiq. But we have to treat him as a Muslim. We cannot say he's a munafiq. We're not allowed. Even the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who knew it was by revelation, and he's Sayyidina Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he knew who they were. He never said these are munafiq and they should be punished. They were left. Abdullah ibn Salul, ibn Ubay ibn Salul, in the days of what's that battle? Tabuk. Yeah, he made fun of the Muslims, and he was leading the hypocrites, And he did so many things. But the Prophet never said to him anything, never told anything to him. And when he came back, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he died in his own lifetime. Abdullah ibn Ubayd, the hypocrite, died in his own lifetime. And he knew he was a hypocrite. But because he had done something good to Ibn Abbas or one of the companions, and because his son was a Muslim, when they were going to bury him, he said, Ya Rasulullah, we have nothing for him to be buried. He took his burda. Unthinkable. Unthinkable, yes. His cover. And he gave it to him. He covered him. He put him in the grave. And he said, and they asked him to do salah for him. And he was about to do salah for him. Imagine this. And Umar radiallahu anhu says, no. Rasulullah, he's a hypocrite. But you cannot see, he did not want to say he's a hypocrite, so I'm not gonna lead salah. I'm not gonna lead salah. And when he did that, Allah revealed to him that he was a hypocrite. And when Umar was complaining to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he's a hypocrite. He told him that the verse in the Quran, he says, if you ask forgiveness for them, or didn't ask forgiveness for them 70 times, you know the hadith, that verse? Huh? There's a verse in the Quran that says, so there are certain people, if you ask forgiveness for them 70 times, Allah will not accept it. And he responded to Sayyidina Umar, he says, I will do it an extra above that. And after that, Allah revealed another verse saying that he was a hypocrite. So, subhanAllah, so the hypocrite, and then there is Ammatun Nas. And we are so lucky to be one of those. Ammatun Nas is you and me, is the masses of the companions. The companions are a different level. But Ammatun Nas are those who, inshallah, will die with Husn Khatima. Believe it or not. You know, this is strange for me to say. But anyone who is a Muslim will see the truth before he dies. And inshallah, he's doing something. He loves Allah and His Prophet. This is Ammatun Nas. And then there is those who are very good too, but they slack. Like Al-Mukhallafun, the three in Tabuk that did not make it with the army just because they were procrastinating. So, you know, and they were really very high. They were the people of Badr. How could they be bad? And then there is and then there's the Siddiqeen. And these Siddiqeen exist in all times. And the Siddiqeen are able to perceive things that you and I can't perceive. See, we all see Al-Mushahada. We all can perceive Al-Mukashaf. It's something that we don't speak about. But when we are about to die, we are able to see things that others don't see. And you ask this to your parents or the elders, those who are in their deathbed, they start saying, I think I saw this or that. Imam al-Sha'rawi, he saw the Prophet ﷺ as he was dying. He came to him and he met with him. Imam Farid al-Ansari, the greatest, one of the greatest and most respectable Salafis in Morocco, he got sick and he went to Belgium or France to have an operation. He came back and his health deteriorated. And if you hear the last lecture that he gave, it's mind-blowing the way he speaks. He's a great usuli. You know, he understands deen. He understands the fiqh and usul. He understands the language of Arabic. If you hear him speak, you don't want to stop listening. And near the end of his life, last lecture that you hear from him, he's witnessing things. The person is witnessing things. And he's still rational. So this is the Mukashafa. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he's above the Siddiqeen. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you know, in Mecca, maybe I'm deviating, I don't even know where I am. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was when he was in Mecca, how many things are from Jannah? Come on. The black stone. Right? The black stone is from Mecca, from Jannah. In Medina, how many things are from Jannah? You know what they are? Uhud. The hadith sahih says, Jabal min al-Jannah. Check it out. Look it up. Wad al-Aqiq. The Prophet ﷺ, Allah told, Jibreel came to him and told him, before you do Hajj, you do two raka'at in Wadi al-Aqiq. This is the miqat. It is a river in Jannah. Yes. There are wells in Medina. There are wells. The Prophet was sitting with the companions, radiallahu anhu, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he was telling them, I am seeing a source from Jannah. A lot of things in Medina. So what is this? This is mukashafa. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was not like the Siddiqeen or like everybody else. He was looking at the angels 24 hours a day. He looked at Jibreel when he came. Don't we agree? He was in that state all the time. When they came to him, remember when they came to him, the guy who complained to Sayyidina Abu Bakr and told him, I think I'm a hypocrite. You know the story? Yeah. He says, I'm a hypocrite. Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu took him to the Prophet. He says, he's complaining that he's a hypocrite. He says, if you were to remain in that state, that you, when you are with me, you would shake hands with the angels. See, if you sit with the Prophet at every moment of the day, you are at a different level. And you start seeing things too. The angels would come and shake your hands in the street, in the bedroom with your wife. He'll shake your hands. Huh? And the scholar, the student, the sahabi who saw the angel, and he came, what's his name? I forget now. So these are the mukashafat. So the siddiqeen are also, they also have this level of mukashafa. So there's different levels of iman and different levels of, okay. Many more hadith and verses from the Quran. Beautiful hadith. Sinfani min ummati idha salaha salaha al-nas. There's two categories of people in my ummah. If they become good, everyone becomes good. And if they spoil, everything becomes spoiled. Al-umara wal-fuqaha. Okay, the leaders, the leaders, and the fuqaha. And then some more here. القلب إذا منع عنه الحكمة والعلم ثلاثة أيام يموت. He's telling us that this is the effect of العلم and حكمة. If we are deprived from it 3 days, like we cannot go without water for more than a certain amount of hours or food, but knowledge and salah and dhikr, we don't care. But he says here, if a person is deprived from wisdom and knowledge 3 days, his heart will die. Al-Hasan al-Basri, he used to say, يُوزَنُ مِدَادَ الْعُلَمَاءِ. This is in the hadith also. يُوزَنُ مِدَادَ الْعُلَمَاءِ بِدَمِ الشُّهَدَاءِ. On the day of judgment, or we can weigh the blood of the shuhada with the ink of the scholars. And it's the ink of the scholars which is heavier. And there's another hadith, of course, that you should follow, you should seek knowledge from the scholars, because scholars, knowledge will be removed. And he explains, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, how knowledge is removed. It's not by knowledge or by the books, it's by the scholars themselves. And he used to say that, تَذَاكُرُ الْعِلْمِ بَعْضَ لَيْلَةٍ أَحَبُّ إِلَيَّ مِنْ إِحْيَائِهَا. To study, you know, a few minutes in the night, like we are doing, alhamdulillah, is better than to worship Allah the entire night. To do rak'at or dhikr. I had a teacher who was, but then there's things we have to weigh. You know, one of my teachers, at my age, I'm more interested in doing dhikr. After a long day at work, you go back home, you know, go to the gym for 2 hours, not just kidding. And then you do something, and you just want to do dhikr and not really read something heavy. So I just tell him, the teacher, I went to my teacher on Saturday morning, and he said, why didn't you review the lesson? I said, well, because I was doing this. I had to do my specific dhikr. He says, you are talibul ilm, you're a student of knowledge. You should spend your time learning and studying. So it depends. Sometimes you don't feel like studying. Also, like just to show you, to give you a picture of what this means. If you go to Al-Haram, or to any of the great universities, in the masjid, al-haram, the adhan is given, and the scholar is still sitting. He doesn't get up to do nafila. Just, you know, pay attention to that one time. You know, dhuhr, maghrib, isha, he's between maghrib and isha, students are sitting around here, adhan is called, they keep quiet, the adhan is done, the teacher continues. Because knowledge is more virtuous than the nafila. But after you're done, make sure you do qada for your nafila. And this is the opinion of Imam al-Shafi'i. Like if you travel and you don't do your nafila, once you have time, make up your nafila. This is the opinion of Imam al-Shafi'i. Imam Abu al-Ghazali, rahimahullah. Someone was sitting with Imam Malik in his house, and he was studying. And the adhan of dhuhr was called. And so his students started to pick up stuff and leave so he can pray nafila. He says, "Where are you doing? You're here studying. This is more virtuous than where you're going." So when I'm not saying something strange, this is fiqh. It's even fiqh, yes. Yes. Sunnah. Don't mess up the sunnah though. Make sure you do the sunnah. In fact, get into the habit of doing the sunnah. But if you're sitting with a teacher, don't miss out the nafila with your teacher. Don't miss out the sitting down with the teacher for your nafila. But do make it up. And from the akhbar, also there are many hadith here from the akhbar, very similar to what we have just mentioned. He says, if you travel to learn just one chapter of knowledge, it's better than to pray 100 nafila, 100 raka'ah. So it's very virtuous. Of course, with the right intention. You have to have the right intention when you seek knowledge. It's not just like that. Okay, so more or less, I don't want to go into more of these virtues. There are many other quotations from scholars, radiallahu anhum. For instance, Sufyan al-Thawri, one time, he went to Asqalan. And he stayed there for a few days. And he told his partner, you have a question? Yeah. Oh, go ahead. No, I don't mind interacting.
Yeah, so in this context, when you talk about seeking knowledge, is that how broad is knowledge? Are you talking about Islamic knowledge, or is it just ilm al-nafi', beneficial knowledge?
In this book, we are talking just about the Islamic knowledge. Okay. But knowledge, he also mentions everything else. He also mentions everything that we need. And then he also gives the ruling of knowledge. Do you have to learn certain knowledge? Do we have to learn everything? Although it's highly virtuous for us to pursue knowledge, not everyone can become a scholar of fiqh and usul and tafsir and, yes.
He also says, I think, for example, if there's a village and there's no doctors and people want to be scholars of your deen, it would be an obligation for one person at least to study like medicine.
Yeah, that falls under the ruling, which is this knowledge, which is not Islamic knowledge, is also far kifaya. That means if you have one person who becomes a doctor in that village, it absolves the rest of the people from becoming doctors. The same and for the same, if you have one person who learns tafsir, it absolves the rest of the people to it's not obligation for the rest of the people. But he does speak about, so she answered your question, you know, so it's also this is the ruling. If it's not there, it becomes wajib, fard kifaya. And that was the second chapter. Second chapter is the ruling of knowledge. في فرض العين وفرض الكفاية من العلوم. And some people have taken knowledge, the Islamic scholars, so seriously that if they go into a place and they become resident of that city or village, and they don't find a certain scholar in a certain madhab, then they become that scholar of that madhab. Okay, so one scholar was a Shafi'i, and he went into a location where there was no Hunafa, so he became Hanifa, Abu Hanifa, a scholar of madhab al-Hanafi. And do you know Dr. Slimi from Toronto? Huh? Dr. Slimi is a Moroccan. He's a doctor, he's a scholar in Ulum al-Din. If he's a Moroccan, he's a Maliki, right? But he settled in Toronto in a neighborhood which is Ahnaf. He became Hanafi. So his fatwa is by the school of Abu Hanifa. So there's a lot of... So قال بعض العلماء قال بعض العلماء So this is exactly what we're talking about in the sense of how one should engage with the community. So the scholars, they say العالم يدخل فيما بين الله وبين خلقه فلينظر كيف يدخل. So when he goes into a community, he's really, what is he doing? He's becoming the medium between Allah and the people. So he has to be careful how he enters in that place. وَرُوِيَ أَنَا سُفْيَانَ الثَّوْرِي. So Sufyan al-Thawri arrives to Asqalan and he spends a few days and he finds no one interested in learning. So he says, let's go. Go and prepare the caravan, we're leaving. He says, no one here is interested in learning. The same with another, so these are two tabi'is, Sa'id, who was it? Ata ibn Abi Rabah, he walks in the room and he finds Sa'id ibn Musayyib, and he's weeping, like he's really sad. He says, what's wrong? Mayyubkika? He says, Laysa ahadun yas'aluni an shay. No one is asking me anything, this deen is going to disappear. We have to be interested. There's no one interested. In one of the, I don't know which century it was, maybe the fourth. When was the Murabitin? We'll find out. Anyways, one of these rulers was coming back from the east, and he met a scholar in Afriqiya, in Tunis, and he was so impressed with his knowledge. He says, give us someone to take him with us to Morocco. And he says, sure. Go to that village. One of my students lives there. He'll tell you who can go with you. So he went and he took someone with him. And that one person was a very, they're all scholars. So he went all the way to Morocco. And in Morocco, those days, it was like the desert. They settled in a place where there was no environment. Wa alaykum salam. And he says, what am I going to do? So he took this great scholar took a number of people with him, and they traveled to Madagascar. Where is that? At the other end of the continent, right? It's an island at the other end of Africa. And there he taught them, and they built a zawiya. A zawiya, what does it mean?
Islamic school.
Yeah. Zawiya, it really means a complex of things. So it's a school with a mosque, with a farm, with a habitat. So people live there, and the students go and they work in the farm. They come back to study at the mosque and learn Quran and so on. So he took a group of people there, and it was wajib for them to pray jama'ah. In the Maliki, it's not wajib. In the Hanbali, it is. In the Maliki, it's sunnah. So it was, he made it wajib for them, even though he was Maliki. And if you did not pray jama'ah in the first rak'ah, you get lashed. You get whipped. So he was very strict. No, because no one was interested. So he took all these people. And then, after a few years, he took them back to Morocco. And these were the fuqaha. So Al-Murabitin was the dynasty of the fuqaha. And that's how, you know, that's what this little chapter is about here. That's, if you really want, if you're a scholar, you have to see how you enter or engage with the community. How do you involve them? How do you make them love religion? Of course, today you cannot do that. You have to be very, very very soft. Is it time for Maghrib?
I think in like 10 minutes.
Okay. So any questions? I mean, I'm done with this, and maybe we can talk about that. By the way, there's no way I can study over the weekend. So I just came from work. Maybe I spent an hour on this. So I'll just go through something else here when we come back, and we'll call it a day, inshallah, or a night. Any questions before we go? Sorry? What is the
name of the book?
This book? Ihya Ulum al-Din. The Revival of Islamic Knowledge. Religious knowledge.
You were mentioning like the different types of chapters, so we're talking about the fifth is the etiquette of the student, which is like the relationship between the teacher. What were the chapters afterwards?
There is Afatul Ilmi wal Ulama. والعلامات الفارقة بين علماء الدنيا والآخرة. And after that is في العقل وفضله وأقسامه وما جاء فيه من الأخبار. This is a little philosophical, and this is the manhaj of Imam Ghazali. He gets in every chapter, there's like a few pages where he gets really philosophical. You have to be patient, and okay, I just go through it, and I don't know what I read. You know what I mean? Yeah.
Are there any books you'd recommend for beginners?
There are many books that everyone else can recommend. I mean, I've read them a while back, but the one that stuck with me is Mukashafat al-Qulub. It's just because it's Imam al-Ghazali, and you have to be very humble reading it, because it's some things you might not understand doesn't mean it's wrong. You just have to be very patient with it.
Also, I missed a little bit of what you said. You mentioned in the story, in a state where you told that if you're in a state of worship, you just understand that's from Allah, and then I kind of lost focus.
And if you have disobeyed Allah, you have to ask forgiveness. So there's four states. Remember that, everyone? Yeah. There's four states. And that's, subhanAllah, that's all we need to know. Eh? That's all we need to know. We have to obey, to follow the sunnah, the sharia, and to avoid the haram. And if we do something wrong, we ask istighfar and we make tawbah. That's it. When did I say that? Did I read it to you?
Yes. You read that.
Okay.
No, it's one of the chapters.
Yeah, okay.
So it's like Adama Dakra is the just the religious scholars, and Adama Dunya is like the scholars.
Yeah, I think that's what it is. Yeah, the scholars of the knowledge which is from the dunya, I guess only the dunya, and the other ones, Allahu A'lam. We'll have to go read the chapter.
There was actually like one of the things like with regards to like students of knowledge, like as they go on their path to become scholars, like they, I don't remember like who was a scholar who said that, when they said that that they entered this like with one of their intentions, like being fame, and then like they said that that as soon as they reach a level, they realize that that would have to be taken away for more knowledge for them to be able to absorb that more knowledge. I'm not sure like where was that mentioned like that.
So say the person entered with the intention of fame and the hereafter of world,
yeah.
But they changed it, the intention.
As they gain more and more knowledge, yeah. They said that the knowledge of the religion, it can't, and for a person to learn more about it, they have to remove that.
Yeah. I think it was Al-Juwayni, the teacher of Imam Al-Ghazali. He says, طلبنا العلم للدنيا فأبى الله إلا أن تكون للآخرة. فأبى الله. So we have sought knowledge for the dunya, but Allah only, you know, He made me seek it for the hereafter, just for the hereafter. I think he's a teacher of Imam Ghazali. Yeah, take your time. Go now, inshallah. I'm fine. Take your time now or after the adhan, how you wish, inshallah. Take a break.